Town Clerk, please call the roll.
Chairman Creelman?
Here.
Counselor Clarkson?
Here.
Counselor Amaro?
Here.
Counselor Chapel?
Yep.
Counselor Jordan?
Yep.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
And Counselor Pearson?
Here. Thank you. Would the audience please arise and join me for the Pledge of Allegiance to our flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have before us the minutes of meeting number one, held on June 10th, 1991, and a special town council meeting number two, held on June 26th, 1991. Are there any particular corrections to the first of the minutes?
Mr. Chairman, thank you. On the meeting number one, where it says presentations to pass board, should be chairman. Other than that, I would move we accept them as amended.
Second.
All those in favor, please signify. Unanimous. And now, secondly, the meeting held on June 26, 1991. Any particular corrections to those minutes?
Mr. Chairman, I'll move they be accepted as printed.
Second.
All those in favor? And Mr. Chappelle, were you in favor of those minutes? Yes. Well, unanimous vote.
Okay.
And now for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Anyone in the audience have any particular concerns to address from the podium? Seeing none, we will proceed to the next item, which allows me to leave my seat up here and come down to the podium myself. Would Lester Jordan please come down to the podium? Good evening.
Good evening.
Lester, why don't you stand over to my side here so everyone on TV can see as well. Very close that. Lester, on behalf of the Town Council and the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, I am pleased to present you a plaque commemorating your completion of over 8 years of service on the Board of Regional Waste Systems. When you began service on the board as Cape Elizabeth's representative, RWS served just four communities, including Cape Elizabeth. All of our trash was baled and then landfilled in Scarborough. As you complete your service, RWS operates the most efficient and safest resource recovery plant in the state of Maine. As a member of the building committee for RWS, you spent countless days and evenings searching for the best method of disposing of our solid waste. You attended DEP hearings, met frequently with bond counsel, and debated every detail from the height of the stack to the cost of the chairs in the RWS boardroom. You even had to attend one board meeting at which the prime topic of discussion was whether or not you needed both ladies' and men's rooms outside the boardroom. You persevered, and now thanks to you and several other volunteers, RWS is recognized as the preeminent provider of solid waste disposal services in the state of Maine. Your tireless efforts and the positive results you achieved persuaded 26 additional communities above the original four to participate. Recently, you were involved in establishing a very successful recycling program that is serving Cape Elizabeth very well. You have also devoted many hours to the development of the demolition waste area planned in the town of Gorham. Lester, we are deeply appreciative of all that you have done for Cape Elizabeth and for the region as a member of the RWS board. So I would like to now present you with this plaque, which reads, Town of Cape Elizabeth presents to Lester E. Jordan for service to Cape Elizabeth and the greater Portland region as a member of the Board of Directors of Regional Waste Systems 1983 to 1991. Thank you very much. I would now like to proceed to reports and correspondence.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Chapel.
On behalf of Irving Chapel, the name is Chapel. The RWS meeting on June the 27th was very interesting when we took up the materials recycling facility being planned for Goro. The two sides of the issue were given in detail that evening by both representatives of the Gorham Planning Board and, of course, the staff and the area representatives to the board for the RWS itself. It seems that the only thing in the way now of getting this thing off the ground and getting it going is the size of the landfill. RWS wants 70 feet of landfill so that they can figure this thing over 23 or 24 years, and the planning board in Gorham would like to see 50 feet. The only trouble with that being it would cut us down to 15 or 16 years, and you can see the difference in the number of years. It's going to make all costs exceedingly more. So we've sent it back to Gorham with our recommendations that we will do all in our power to keep it at 50 feet. But if the necessity arises where in that period of the 23 or 24 years that we have to go to 70 feet, that we will be allowed to without going back to Gorham for something, because you can't tell who the planning boards or the council might be 20 years from now. That's going back to Gorham, already has, and they're having a meeting, I believe, next week. And after they have discussed it and come back to us, I'll have a further report for you.
Thank you, Councillor Chapel. Other reports and correspondence. Yes, Councillor Pearson.
Yes, Chairman Creelman. I just wanted to make a plea to anyone watching out in TV land, the members of the audience present, that the town council is soliciting applications for a new town center planning committee. The application deadline is this Friday, and we urge anyone that's interested in being a part of developing a plan for the town center or a town concept, if you will, for Cape Elizabeth to please come to the town hall and see the town clerk and fill out an application. Thank you.
Councilor Amaro.
I just would like to announce that Congressman Tom Andrews has established a municipal advisory committee, which consists of municipal officials from this district, and that I'm very pleased to be serving on that committee. It's a nonpartisan committee, and we will be meeting with him four times a year. And so, like any of my fellow counselors or any members of the public who have issues relating to how decisions from the federal government affect municipal government, really like to hear from you. And at our first meeting, which was last week, we spent a lot of time discussing federal mandates and how non-federally funded federal mandates affect municipal government. And we also talked a lot about the cost of implementing the Clean Air Act, Clean Water Act, et cetera. So I'll keep you updated on that committee as it progresses.
Thank you. Thank you. Other reports. I had the privilege of attending the Greater Portland Council of Governments General Assembly annual meeting with Councillor Chapel and Councillor Amaro. During that particular meeting, the new slate of officers for the upcoming year will be Ann Thaxter, Councillor of New Gloucester, as president, Tom Allen, Councillor of Portland, actually the mayor right now, first vice president, Ann Swardlick, Counselor of Yarmouth, as Second Vice President, and David Williams, Counselor of Cumberland, as Treasurer. During the meeting, there also was a report. We've talked about regionalization recently on the council, and the Greater Portland Council of Governments does have a joint services division whereby a variety of items can be purchased in larger numbers, which allows individual municipalities to save money. And I would announce that the cost savings as of February 1991 over the last fiscal year for Cape Elizabeth was $10,341.72. So we're delighted that we can continue to save money by getting on larger bids when these services need to be purchased. I also had the privilege of attending the 6th Annual Citizen Crime Watch Awards presentation a couple of weeks ago at Portland City Hall. This was an opportunity to honor two of our citizens in Cape Elizabeth, Nina Hendrickson and Jamie O'Quinn, for their bold and noble efforts with respect to crime prevention. Very proud to be part of that particular ceremony. Any other reports or correspondence? Well, let us proceed then to item 31 this evening, which is a public hearing on our firearms ordinance. I will ask Councillor Cogsall to present this particular ordinance as chair of our ordinance committee.
Thank you. The changes in the firearms ordinance came about from a letter that was presented to us by Chief Pickering in order to make them more current. So we are proposing to eliminate the current Article 1 pertaining to handgun control, since state statutes preempt the town from regulating handguns, and the current Article 2 is proposed to become Article 1. It is proposed to eliminate the 12-hour notice period to the police department before depredation activities could occur. Notice is still proposed to be required, but with no time limit. There are minor semantic changes, which are recommended in 19-1-2, which was formerly 9-2-2. It is recommended that the penalty for violation be increased from not to exceed $100 to not to exceed $500. Under section 9-1-2, the semantic changes are, in reference to the depredation, that applicable state statutes would replace any statutory requirements, therefore. It eliminates the 12 hours, and then we insert again the word state under statute. Under the penalty, section 9-1-3, the fine is increased to $500. Mr. Chairman?
Thank you very much, Councillor Cogsall. I will now open up the firearms ordinance public hearing to the general public. Are there any citizens in the audience who wish to speak on this particular item? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing, and I will entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman,
please.
I move we adopt the new firearms ordinance as proposed.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion at this particular time? I'll ask for a vote. All in favor, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Let us now proceed to the second public hearing of the evening, item number 32, to consider proposed changes to the zoning ordinance relating to daycare uses, and we will take any necessary action. Again, I will defer to my colleague, Councillor Cogsall, chair of the ordinance committee.
Okay, these amendments are intended to expedite the review process for small daycare operations and to give a definition for day nurseries. Daycare for six or fewer children in the operator's residence would not require review by the zoning board and the planning board if four conditions of operation are met. Instead, a use permit would be issued by the code enforcement officer. The ordinance committee has added an amendment that the expedited process be available to day nurseries in the BA zone as well as in the residential zones. Daycare operations for more than six children or daycare not provided in the operator's residence is defined as a daycare home and would continue under the existing process of the zoning and planning board review. So before us tonight, the amendments would be under section 19-1-3 definition, daycare home, a facility which provides a regular program of care and protection for seven or more children under the age of 16 or any number of children in other than the operator's residence for any part of the day. The other definition, day nursery, a facility which provides a regular program of care and protection in the operator's residence for up to six children under the age of 16 for any part of the day. Changes in section 19-2-2, resident A, district permitted uses. Subsection C, it would include the daycare home. It also would stipulate, except that a day nursery shall not be subject to conditional use review by the zoning board or site plan review by the planning board. A day nursery shall require a use permit from the code enforcement officer. Upon application for a use permit, a notice shall be sent to the abutters within 500 feet of the property where a day nursery is proposed. If no objection is received in writing within 30 days of mailing of the notice by the code enforcement officer, a use permit may be issued, provided that all of the following criteria are met. Criteria one, the day nursery shall not operate before the hours of 7 a.m. or after the hours of 7 p.m. Number two, a fenced outdoor play area shall be provided with a minimum area of 75 square feet per child. Number three, no outside play shall be allowed before 9 a.m. on Saturdays, Sundays, and holidays. Number four, adequate lighting shall be provided at the vehicle drop-off and pickup area. And also added, use permit appeals by residents and applicants shall be directed to the zoning board. Under section 19-2-4, business district A permitted uses, we are now including day nursery. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. At this particular point, I will open up the public hearing to our citizens on the daycare standards. Are there citizens who wish to come forward and discuss any and all issues pertaining to this public hearing? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and I will ask for a motion.
Mr. Chairman,
please.
I move that we adopt the daycare zoning amendments and standards as presented.
Second motion.
Any further discussion on this particular topic? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Our third and last public hearing this evening, item number 33, to consider a full-time malt, spirituous, and vinous liquor license for the Good Table Restaurant and take any necessary action. I will again defer to the chair of our ordinance committee, Councillor Cogsall. I will defer from Councillor Cogsall to our clerk, Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you. The council has before it the renewal application from the Good Table. The application has been complete. The public hearing has been advertised properly. Mr. Christopoulos is here this evening if you have any questions for him. There is a minor change in the application that they would like to include the spirituous liquor on their application.
Everything is in order.
Yes, it is.
Let me now open the public hearing on the full-time liquor license of the Good Table to the public. Are there citizens in the audience who wish to come forward and speak on this particular item? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing and ask for a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move approval of the full-time liquor license for the Good Table Restaurant.
I second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you very much. I would now like to beg the indulgence of anyone waiting to go on a particular item, and in deference to the chairperson of deference to the superintendent of our school system here, I would like to take an item out of order, which will require a suspension of the rules of the council. Might I have a motion?
I move suspension of the rules.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. I would like to take item number 44 next. This is to consider a report from the Cape Elizabeth School Board to designate the swimming pool at Cape Elizabeth High School as the Donald A. Richards Pool and take any necessary action. And I would ask our superintendent, Mrs. Goldman, to please come down to the microphone here and tell us about this particular proposal.
Thank you. I am assuming that's effective. And I also appreciate being moved forward a little bit and appreciate people in the audience. I won't take too long. As I think all of you are probably aware, Don Richards gave us notice of his intention to resign about 2 months ago. And there has certainly been a great deal of notice taken of the 30 years that he has spent, particularly in connection with his outstanding record as a swim coach. And since this is a matter that is dealing with swimming, that's what my remarks will be geared to. Obviously, he has been involved with teaching and other activities, but this particular request has to do with his career as a swim coach. He has been the only swim coach in Cape Elizabeth when the high school was opened and the pool was part of that. He was had already been the coach of the swimming team. I'm sure he was involved in planning and looking ahead to the future, and he was very quickly an integral part of building those teams. The girls swim team started in 61 and the boys started in 1970. Don has been in the system since 1961 and was, of course, instrumental in getting the whole sport going. He has been main swim coach of the year, including this time when he was elected to that honor for the eighth time. He appeared in Sports Illustrated Faces in the Crowd last year after swim teams had their 700th win, and they now have over 740 wins with only 60 losses. I think that the school committee was informally approached by a number of people to consider what process we could use in order to designate the pool in his name. After some conversation with Michael, we felt that the appropriate process to use was to ask citizens who were particularly interested to come forward with letters to the school committee and for us to have an opportunity to discuss it at our board meeting. I do have copies, or a copy, of the some of the correspondence I had. If anybody would be interested, be happy to leave it with you. We have a letter from present and previous members of the swim team signed by 39 people who were involved with that, a letter from Robert and Sharon Small, whose youngsters are still swimming in at the college level and are certainly appreciative of the kind of start they had here. After hearing from the next year's co-captains of the boys and girls swim team, the Cape Elizabeth School Board did in fact discuss this issue and voted to further the recommendation to you for your consideration. I certainly am here and happy to present you with that. I recognize that it is probably, I don't know if it's a first, but I don't think we have any plaques over our cafeteria at the middle school. And I don't imagine there are other pieces of the buildings that perhaps would be appropriate. This is kind of a unique situation. Don has been Mr. Swimming in Cape Elizabeth for 20 years and actually before that. So as he leaves us, I think that just to leave you with one final quote, when there was an article in the Portland Press Herald on April 30th, Keith Weatherby, whom I'm sure you know is the athletic director at the high school, he's quoted as saying, "I knew Don was thinking about retiring from teaching, but I had thought he would stay on as a coach," Weatherby said. "It's going to be quite a hole for us to fill. When you think of swimming at Cape Elizabeth, you think of Don Richards. He's an institution." And I think it's that kind of feeling that has brought forth a generalized response from his former students, swim youngsters, and people that he has worked with for that request. And I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Are there any particular questions for Dr. Goldman with respect to this proposal?
Having none?
Sounds good to me.
Well, thank you for an opportunity to present it.
Thank you very much, Dr. Goldman. Hearing no particular questions, I will take a motion.
Mr. Chairman, it's with a great deal of pride that I would like to move approval of the naming of the swimming pool in Cape Elizabeth after Donald A. Richards. And that's my motion, but I'd like to have a chance to speak to it.
Sure.
I'll second.
The second is heard.
That Don Richards, along with what Superintendent Goldman has said, has not only been Mr. Swimming in Cape Elizabeth, I think he's been Mr. Swimming in the state of Maine for a long time. And the type of leadership that he has held up for all of the children in the state of Maine, I think it is so important in all sporting activities, because his philosophy is that you're competing against yourself. And if you work as hard as you possibly can, you can succeed by improving on the goals that you set for yourself. And I think that philosophy is admirable, not only in sporting activities, but it's admirable in academic activities. And I'd like to see more of that type of philosophy reflected in our schools across the state of Maine. So I think that we've been honored to have Don Richards serve in the Cape Elizabeth Public Schools during his entire career as an educator and as a coach so far, and I think it's a great tribute to him to name the pool after him.
Well, is there anyone that can improve on that?
I don't think I can improve on it, and I go along with everything Councilor Amaro has said, and I have known Don Richards for a good number of years, ever since he's been here. And I was on the building committee when we was putting the school together, and I know he was there when we talked about the swimming pool. And it was quite a time there, one time there, whether we was going to get the swimming pool or not. And he was pretty instrumental in talking to a few people that how great it would be for the town of Cape Elizabeth. I always accused part of the building committee of setting the pool off to one side, so when we went to town meeting, if they wanted to chop something off, it's easier to chop the pool off than it was the auditorium, because they was pushing hard between an auditorium and a swimming pool. But we managed to get it through the town meeting, and I believe it's been a great asset to town of Cape Elizabeth. And along, as Jane said, as Don Richards been recognized all over the state, not just Cape Elizabeth.
Jim, I might add that along with Councilor Jordan, I've known Don for at least 30 years, and he's had one of my sons and one of my granddaughters in his swimming, and he couldn't be more respected or better thought of amongst the younger people in the community. I know that through my many years with Boy Scouts. A lot of those were on his team. He's just been a great team player and a great inspiration to the youth of Cape Elizabeth.
Further discussion? Mr. Manager, my understanding would be that if and when we pass this item this evening, this would take effect immediately?
It would take effect immediately, but my guess is that there might want to be some ceremony at which the council and the school board gave Don a representation of this designation.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that clarifies it. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Have a unanimous vote, so that at this point, the Cape Elizabeth High School swimming pool will be known as the Donald A. Richards Pool. Congratulations, Mr. Richards. Thank you. Connie. At this point, I would like to proceed to item number 34, to consider authorizing Fort Williams Park to be utilized for a British car show on September 8, 1991, and take any necessary action. And I will ask our town manager to present item 34.
Yes, the town council has before it a letter from William Bremer, who is one of the representatives, along with Bob Morneau of the British car folks. This would be the second annual request for the car show. They had a very successful show last year. There weren't any problems at all. Had very positive comments from everyone who attended the show. It would be on the old road along the parade ground by the old main entrance. Cape Elizabeth Lions Club would have their concession stand present to serve coffee and whatever else they would like to earn some money doing on that particular day. The British Car Organization will pay a dollar per registered vehicle. They're expecting up to 170 vehicles. Those are essentially the highlights, and the Fort Williams Committee did unanimously recommend that this be approved by the town council.
Mr. Bremer or Mr. Morneau, would you like to say a few words about your upcoming event?
Thank you, Mike. I can't improve on what Mike has said. I would like to ask, I'm certainly here to answer any questions. In the letter, I think it's noted that I will assume the responsibility to ensure that the dollar per car registration fee is properly turned over to the town in a prompt manner. I would ask if you would slightly amend item 34 to also approve a rain date for September 15th. Many British car fans don't want to take their cars out in the rain because the rust, the parts just fall off immediately. But if you could give us a rain date, I think the advisory board certainly approved a rain date of 15.
So noted.
I think we noted that up to 170 cars, no more than 170 cars would be permitted to register. Something less than that, about 150 came last year. However, we did not have 150 cars along that row at one time. People came and left during the course of the day, and there probably wasn't more than 50 or 75 cars at any one time in the 6 hours that the show ran, from roughly 9 till 3. I'm certainly able to answer any other questions.
Some questions for Mr. Bremer. Councilor Cogsall.
I was just wondering what the hours were going to be, just so other people can attend.
Well, I don't remember the exact, I think roughly the public hours would be roughly 9 till 3. The advisory board gave us time for something like 7:30 or so until about 5, so we could, you know, set up and clean up, and which we will set up some, identify some volunteer marshals to keep order, certainly, and put cars in the right place and not let them drive on inappropriate areas, and also to make sure that the park is properly clean when we leave. And I think the director of public works had volunteered to provide us a couple of, I don't know, sawhorses or what have you to guide people in the right direction, and he felt that would not be a problem, as I recall.
Are there other questions of Mr. Bremer? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bill, may I have a motion on item 34?
Mr. Chairman, I'll move that we grant the British Car Show at Fort Williams for Sunday, September the 8th, and a rain date, September the 15th, 1991.
Second that, Mr. Chairman.
Any further discussion on this particular event? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a question, perhaps best put to the manager. I'm wondering if what kind of discussion, if any, there was about having a $2 fee per registered car for this. That seems, my recollection is that's what we tend to charge for parking at the fort, and I was wondering if this, that kind of discussion was entertained.
I don't recall a whole lot of discussion. Quite a bit of the discussion at the meeting centered on ensuring that there wasn't, that there was not an overflow of vehicles, and there was also a lot of discussion about the process that the committee was utilizing for reviewing requests. But there was, I don't think there was any discussion at all about $2 versus one.
I would ask the council to consider the $2 fee per registered car to be consistent with our charges for parking at the fort.
Are you?
I'd like to hear discussion.
That?
I don't need. I'm not putting it as an amendment at this point.
Is there some response to Councillor McLaughlin's suggestion that there be a $2 fee that would be paid to the town of Cape Elizabeth per registered vehicle in the show?
Chairman Creelman, the man's redundant. We'll have to change that. No, I just had a question. I didn't know what this might entail as far as town services. Does it require any setup or breakdown, and does the dollar per car actually cover cost, $170? Because as we, I think we discussed sometime not too long ago about vehicle intensive, people intensive, a combination of above. I want to know if the, does the show have, it's basically open to the general public, anyone that's in the park can also walk by in addition to the participants that are displaying their vehicles?
Yes.
Is that correct? Is it?
It's very, it's really quite an informal.
Okay.
That structure is a very interesting. Okay. So yes, probably the park. I think it's very sad. I did not bring the pictures from last year, but I think it's clear that, you know, the area was not overwhelmed with either cars or with people driving the cars. It was quite a low-key event. So I think it's tough to call people. I don't really think it is. It's not the intent of what we're making that noise.
Mm-hmm.
It's intended to be just a gathering of
enthusiasts.
Car really, and okay. You know, have the public and any of the public affairs to provide some of our chat.
Okay. Thank you.
To answer your question about the fee, it goes back to the process, and it to no fault of this group, there was a couple different problems with the process, and that was not studied as well as it should have been before the meeting as a result of the process breaking down slightly. But, you know, so much of the cost, you know, is intangible. You know, we aren't going to have direct police costs. We're not going to have direct additional public works costs. The portable toilets, you know, usually we would charge a group this size pro-rata share of those, but, you know, this would probably cover that.
Okay. And just to get a feel for it. Thank you.
Is there any other response to the formal suggestion of there being a $2 fee?
Mr. Chairman, as far as this year goes and where they have already discussed it with the Four Williams Advisory Committee, I would go along with the dollar fee and put them on notice. If they're back next year, it's likely to be $2 anyway.
Councilor McLaughlin, did you want to make a motion with your suggestion or?
With the lack of discussion, no, thank you.
Any further discussion on the on item 34? We have a motion and we have a second. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Bremer. Hope it's a large success. Will you have the fellow that's dressed up as that beefeater guy at the gate?
Well, we may not have exactly that person.
Similar. Very nice. Very nice. Very nice. Let us proceed to item number 35. This is to consider authorizing a summer baseball league to reserve the parade ground softball field at Fort Williams Park and take any necessary action. I will defer this issue to our town manager, Mr. McGovern.
I had thought there would be someone here representing this particular issue. I don't know if the person is out of the game, but if there is no one here, I would suggest that perhaps you table this to the last item in the meeting to see if a representative does come in.
Do I have a motion for tabling?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? I'll table the item number 35 until the end of the meeting. Item 36 is to consider a recommendation from the Appointments Committee regarding a proposed amendment to the Statement of Policy, Appointments to Boards and Commissions, and take any necessary action. I would defer this issue at this time to Councillor Pearson, our chairman of the Appointments Committee of the Town Council.
Thank you, Chairman Crowman. The Appointments Committee, prompted by concerns that the Land Trust, being a private organization, the Conservation Commission, being a town organization, and both essentially involved in the same respect towards their goals, towards preservation of land in town, and that the Planning Board, in its capacity, does have firsthand contact with developers and private individuals wishing to or required to donate lands to the town of Cape Elizabeth, propose and recommend that Section 8 of the policy of appointments to standing boards and commission reads, members of the Planning Board and the Conservation Commission may not concurrently serve as members of the Governing Board of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. And the reason we do this is just to avoid any perceived conflict of interest that might arise because of that association.
Thank you. Carl? I believe, Dr. Rand, are you the president at this particular time of the Land Trust? Please come right down and please speak to this issue.
Thank you for the opportunity to speak on this. I have a few words, and we seem to have 9 out of 15 directors of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. We had 10 until Lester left, who, and some of them I think may also wish to have some comments after I've spoken, because we've not met on this together yet. In fact, when I heard of this agenda item, which was not until a call from your chairman 3 days ago, I did not understand it, and I still don't. So I thought that this issue must be the result, at least in part, of either misinformation or perhaps not enough information about the land trust. Perhaps then you might allow me to take a few minutes to provide some background about the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust and its real need to have as much collaboration as possible with the town, which is the goal of that section of our bylaws which you wish to render inoperable. 12 days from now, on the 20th of July, the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission will celebrate its 20th anniversary. The commission was formed primarily to apprise the Planning Board, the Council, and the town's administration about the Cape's natural resources and to suggest priorities to them for the preservation and protection of open space. Acting on these priorities, the Commission obtained, in its first 15 years, conservation easements or restricted deeds over 40 acres of open space in the town, plus a number of pedestrian easements that form the foundation of its Greenbelt plan. Most of these acquisitions were the result of negotiation with developers during the permitting process of subdivisions. It soon became clear, however, that the Commission was losing land preservation opportunities by not being able to exercise other methods of land preservation, particularly the ability to raise funds to purchase conservation land, the ability to act swiftly to accept time-limited offers, and the ability to confer and negotiate actively with landowners regarding conservation options for their land. Each of these approaches is best pursued by a land trust, a private, not-for-profit organization of and for the citizens of the town. Hence, in the fall of 1985, members of the Conservation Commission and many other actively concerned citizens of the Cape formed the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Because the goals and activities of the Land Trust are so vitally integrated with those of the town, it is very important that the Council has a clear idea of our purposes and our limitations as defined in our Articles of Incorporation. Briefly, we must be operated exclusively for charitable, educational, civic, historical, cultural, and scientific purposes under the terms of Section 501(c)(3) of the IRS Code. And our activities and purpose must be solely to receive and administer properties and funds for the promotion of conservation and the preservation of natural resources of the town of Cape Elizabeth for the benefit of the general public. So with respect to conflict of interest, no member of the land trust can benefit individually no matter what we do. Conflict of interest requires the alternative requires an alternative benefited party. In the instance of the land trust directorship, having the guidance of a member of the planning board and the conservation commission, the only benefited parties are the citizens of the town and the conserved land itself. I draw your attention to the fact that both the planning board and the conservation commission have been inestimably helped by having realtors, developers, lawyers, and other potentially and actually conflicted citizens among their members. Excusing themselves from discussions when they are conflicted has been a matter of course, following the guidelines supplied by the town attorney. Why is the land trust to be handled differently when we particularly need to coordinate our activities with the town, and the town needs to have its viewpoint expressed with the power of a vote? I guess another question I have is, what's the problem? It seems to me that since its inception, the land trust has been working effectively with the planning board and the conservation commission directors, reacting to four landowners who decided at the last moment to make year-end contributions. The trust was able to preserve a central confluence of the green belt at the foot of Willow Brook, a wooded enclave in the developed northeast section of the town, a perpetual view of the Atlantic beyond Reef Road, and a piece of the upland edge of the Spearwink Marsh off Wells Road. With all due respect, the town could not have responded with the dispatch that was necessary in these instances. And in two other occasions, we've had the opportunity, or have earned through protracted effort the opportunity, to conserve two high priority parcels, one on the Great Pond and the other at the end, at the head of Spearwink Avenue, the perpetual protection of which has been further guaranteed by conservation easements which we gave to the town. In the most recent instance, a few weeks ago, the tables were turned. After much discussion with the Conservation Commission, the dedication of two wetland parcels went to the town when the stipulation of the deed restrictions were unacceptable to the trust. To conclude, I'm very concerned that the council does not appreciate how necessary it is that the Land Trust, the Conservation Commission, and the Planning Board all work together to affect the conservation goals of the town and its citizens as expressed in the comprehensive plan. 657 of those citizens, including 6 out of 7 members of your town council, have indicated their support of the trust through contributions. The way to assure that all avenues are open, to assure the appropriate preservation and remaining Cape Elizabeth open space, including that addressed by the will of Thomas Jordan, is to allow the coordination that is provided by the ex officio positions in the land trust directorship. Strictly as a postscript, I urge you to assure yourselves of the legal appropriateness of your proposal. I did ask our consultant attorney to take as much of a look as 4 hours would provide, and she has some concerns, which, if you don't mind, I will read. They're not long. This came to me today by fax from Northeast Harbor. As I understand the situation, the town of Cape Elizabeth is considering a resolution or ordinance that would prohibit members of the Planning Board or Conservation Commission from becoming officers of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Conversely, I assume that it would prevent the town council from appointing anyone who held officer status with the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust. Here's a brief look. I hope I've looked into it sufficiently. The proposition viewed broadly seems to be in conflict with constitutionally protected rights of association and perhaps even of free speech. Would the council vote to keep out offices of development corporation, construction companies, or Ducks Unlimited as well? You can add to that list. I think the appropriate solution is to have persons abstaining from a vote if there is a clear conflict of interest. I can't see any compelling rationale for a blanket prohibition. Procedurally, the idea has legal problems. The municipal offices must appoint members of the Conservation Commission in accordance with the procedures set out in Title 30A MRSA Paragraph 3261, unless they have established another procedure under their home rule authority. The town cannot add requirements to the statutory procedure unless they do it under home rule authority. Home rule authority has to do with the municipal charter and all of the procedural rules that are set out in it. Some towns, for instance, might establish a conservation commission by vote of the inhabitants rather than by appointment of the municipal officers. I doubt this is the case in Cape Elizabeth, and it isn't. In any event, this all means that any procedure that departs from the statutory procedure for appointing members would have to be made a part of the town's charter with all the procedural requirements of amending or reforming that charter. I won't go into that, but suffice it to say that it isn't quick, and it's subject to court review. Time prohibited to look into the statutory procedures for appointing members to the planning board, but the issues are probably the same. There is also the argument that this council shouldn't try to tell the next council what sort of people they can and cannot appoint. As it is, they have the power to appoint whomever they can agree on. Why not just appoint people they trust? If they did make this rule and a commissioner later became an officer of the land trust, they would risk major legal challenges if they tried to enforce the rule by impeachment. This is not only bad policy, it is probably unconstitutional. Then there's a postscript at the end of it. Pete, the Maine Municipal Association just called. They agree, particularly regarding the constitutional issue. They suggest that the town manager call the Maine Municipal Association a private attorney before going ahead. A long-winded response to your suggestion. I will either take questions right now, or may I suggest that you call on Mr. Clifford or Mr. Wadman, who also have something to say about this.
Dr. Rand, who was the letter from?
Karen Warden, who was the attorney for the Maine Coast Heritage Trust.
Is the will of the council to listen to more input before addressing Dr. Rand's concerns? Is that the general feeling at this point? It's clear that there are several members of the land trust here, and we're delighted to hear from all of you. I would only ask that any information or thoughts be relatively new to what Dr. Rand has already shared with us. In that effect, Mr. Clifford, would you like to come up to the podium?
Thank you, Mr. Creelman. Members of the council, please don't confuse brevity with sincerity, but I feel very strongly about this issue. And as a former president of the Land Trust, currently a director and also former member of the Conservation Commission, I've seen the best of this working relationship between the town and the Land Trust, and I believe that it has to be tied in as tightly as possible in order to make it work as effectively as it has. We could give you a lot of examples, I think, of how this relationship has developed over the past few years and how effective it's been. Again, in the interest of brevity, I won't belabor that. I'd like to speak on the issue of conflict, however. I believe that all of us in any representative situation in the town of Cape Elizabeth at times will encounter conflicts, whether serious or not. And I'd like to think we all had the judgment to be able to overcome them in one way or another. I believe that the current arrangement whereby we have two directors representing the Conservation Commission and the Planning Board has in fact helped to prevent conflicts rather than to enhance them or create an opportunity for that. The example I'd like to give you is, as we've worked over the years with developers offering parcels of land directly to the land trust and to the town, with our directors being involved also, the two directors I mentioned on the Conservation Commission and Planning Board, we're able to sort out what the best position is for both bodies to take, the town and the land trust as a public and private entities. In order to ensure that the land is preserved and in the best possible manner on behalf of the citizens of the town. I'm going to read you in conclusion a letter which I wrote in 1989 as president of the Land Trust at the direction of our directors with considerable input from the then representatives on our directors or board of directors from the Planning Board and the Land Trust. I will omit the name of the individual to whom it was written and the project, but have no problem in conveying those details to any of you individually. Since the mission of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust is to preserve valuable areas of open space for the future enjoyment of the townspeople, we would be interested in obtaining interest in selected portions of your proposed development. As you and I have discussed, prior to consideration by the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust Board of Directors, the boundaries and the accessibility to the public will have to be defined. Because of our strong desire to work cooperatively with the town's planning board and conservation commission, we feel that decisions regarding specific areas to be preserved should be derived from, rather than to precede, your presentations to them. We certainly hope, of course, to be a keenly interested participant in this process. And the gist of this is that early on we realized the pitfall of a developer playing the land trust against the town and discovered, very happily, that this close cooperative relationship, which is enhanced by these directors with interests in both sides, can avoid a developer making end runs on one body or another. For instance, claiming to the planning board that he has made certain arrangements with the land trust, which may in fact not be so. I would certainly implore you to think very carefully before you change what we all, I believe, perceive to be a situation that's working very well and is certainly not unique to the town of Cape Elizabeth. As I think Peter indicated, we were advised when we were setting up our charter by the Maine Coast Heritage Trust to have this specific language in the charter for very good reasons. And I think it's true that of the 60 to 70 land trusts around the state, most have, in one way or another, this type of relationship with the towns in which they operate. Thank you very much, and I'm sure that any of us would be happy to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you, Mr. Clifford. Are there others from the Land Trust? Mr. Wadman?
Bill Wadman, 23 Old Colony Lane, no criminal record, no outstanding traffic tickets, taxes paid on time. And tonight, the bone of contention. I am the only person at issue in this particular change of the ordinance, being a Conservation Commission representative to the Land Trust. I am the immediate past chairman of the Conservation Commission, the immediate past treasurer of the Land Trust, and I feel this rather personally. I have served this community for at least a quarter of a century in elected and appointed positions. There have been questions about my ability, both from me and from others. There have been questions about my decisions from me and from my others, including my wife. There have been long weekends, there have been evenings, there have been afternoons, there have been field trips, there have been all sorts of things. But not once has there ever been any consideration of a conflict of interest or any kind of work except for the betterment of the town of Cape Elizabeth. And that goes for everybody that I have known that has served this town in either an elective or an appointed position. I can solve the problem for you very quickly by ending my service to the community with the adoption of this change to the ordinance, because I can assure you that if this is the sort of recognition that's afforded people who have given of their time and of a good part of their lives, why, I'll go with the Land Trust and the Conservation Commission. Will benefit from their work continually, but perhaps not from my presence. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wadman. Mrs. Fritz.
Carol Fritz. I'm currently a director of the Land Trust and a former member of the Planning Board for 7 or so years. I'd just like to urge the Council to allow members of the Planning Board and Conservation Commission to serve as members of the Land Trust. I think Mr. Leahy's letter clearly says that there isn't an actual conflict of interest as it applies to planning boards and is in the state law. What he seems to base his argument on is the appearance of conflict. And I guess the thing that he really didn't mention in his letter that I think is important is that the town council, in its wisdom, has set up the relationship within the ordinances for the planning board to follow. The connection between the town council, the planning board, the land trust, and the conservation commission. So it seems to me that there just isn't even an appearance when the council has said that a developer should set aside land and put it into either the Land Trust or the Conservation Commission.
Thank you, Mrs. Fritz. I see Mrs. Carson.
Thank you very much. I just had a couple of comments. Could you please tell me who, I don't know because I don't have a list, who are the other members of the Appointments Committee besides Carl? I mean, is it a three, Jane and?
That's three.
And Irving, okay. I tried to create today, in talking with Dr. Rand, some of the scenarios which would bring this issue forward as an agenda item, since I actually just heard about it today. And I read the agenda, and I sat with Dr. Rand and talked with him this afternoon. I tried to create some of the scenarios that might create this sort of conflict. And because I couldn't do it, and therefore really couldn't figure out how this became an issue in the way this way, I hope that maybe as you debate it, you know, we're here to speak, but I don't know what we're speaking on, because I don't know what your problem is, what the council's problem is with the issue. So I would hope that maybe as you go through your discussion, if you're going to continue the discussion this evening, that it's possible, I mean, if our comments are ended now, and then you get into discussions, and we're in no position to give you any further information or to make any further comments, because we don't know how you got here. Is it possible that we could, or that one person, Dr. Rand, for instance, the president, could comment during your discussion, you could talk to him other times, you could ask him any questions, or I'd like you to consider that. The other thing I want you to consider is I'm not as old as Mr. Wadman, so I have not served anywhere near as long. But most of you know that I do have this one thing I feel driven to say. We suffer from paralysis from overanalysis. I feel that we're closing down again. We're making rules and regulations, and I haven't quite seen how this one applies yet to the advantages to the citizens of the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Carson. Are there others from the Land Trust?
.442 Old Ocean House Road. And I would been reading the letter from Monahan, Leahy, Hochschild, and Libby, and this is what bothers me. Mrs. Cogshaw has inquired if this is a conflict of interest, where, under the subdivision ordinance, the planning board must address and enforce a provision for the dedication of land to the homeowners association, or in lieu thereof, to the town or an appropriate nonprofit third-party group or organization. What I don't understand is why isn't the planning board facing just such a conflict of interest by representing the town itself? Why couldn't the planning board members be accused of favoring the interests of the town over those of the homeowners or association or an appropriate nonprofit third-party group or organization? What's more, since the planning board members themselves represent a diverse group of interests and affiliations, they must bring a conflict of interest to every issue. I consider the land trust bylaws, which provide for two ex officio directors representing the town's conservation committee and the planning board, to be a perfect example of good faith and a determination to work with and not against the town. And as further proof of lack of self-interest, these two directors are not chosen by the land trust, but are designated by the chairman of each, the conservation committee and the planning board. Why is the nonprofit land trust being discriminated against? The advice and the counsel of the two ex officio directors is of great value to us in setting our goals and heading us in the right direction for the town's needs. Why should the land trust be deprived of that advice and counsel when its articles of incorporation are entirely designed for the benefit of the town?
Thank you for your comments. Other members of the public? Seeing none, I will return the discussion to the council. My fellow councilors, who would like to comment on this particular item?
Well, perhaps, Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Surely.
At that point, I was chairman of the council, and we had a letter written by Dr. Rand to the planning board requesting nominees for the position on their board of directors. At that point, there was some question as to whether or not there could be an appointment that would be approved by the town. Since in some discussions that we'd had with some developers, they had made a couple of comments as to being confused as to who was wearing what hat at what time. And we had had this problem a few years ago, 3 years ago as a matter of fact, when there was dedication of land that was going totally to the land trust, and we changed the land trust name to a nonprofit organization because it was confusing some of the developers. So that was the reason that we were just verifying for our own legal reasons whether or not a member of the planning board who is ultimately going to make a decision on the subdivision could really sit in on some of the negotiations or be party to the discussions for the land trust. It didn't mean in any way that the citizens themselves would be deprived of your benefit, because no one could possibly have done more for the town than the land trust as far as obtaining open space and access. But we needed to be able to keep things as clear as possible, and where there were perceived conflicts as to whom they were talking to at the time, we thought it'd be much simpler if we could get the legal opinion. And Mr. Leahy did advise that there is a conflict if it's a perceived confusion, and we as members of the town council, whenever there's a perceived conflict of interest on any item on our agenda, always withdraw, even though legally by statute there may not be the monetary conflict. As Mrs. Poole pointed out, the letter does address only the planning board, so perhaps we do need to get more of an opinion as far as the appointment from the Conservation Commission. But we do have a legal statement as far as the planning board position is concerned.
Councillor Amaral.
Yeah, first of all, this is not an ordinance that's being proposed. This is an addition to the council's policy statement regarding appointments to committees. And within that policy statement are our positions that a person can serve on only one standing committee in town. There's the two-term limit, et cetera, and seven other qualifiers. So we're not trying to add another ordinance to the town, but we're trying to add an additional statement, which we think helps to clarify what we've run into, a problem that we've run into over and over again over the past several years. The policy statement would not bar anybody from becoming a member of the land trust. That's not an issue. In fact, we encourage people to become members of the land trust. The only item at issue is the board of directors. And the reason that the council is concerned about that item is because the Conservation Commission, which is a committee appointed by the council, makes recommendations to the planning board regarding the dedication of property according to our ordinance, which needs to be set aside, is required to be set aside by developers. And that recommendation is as to whether that piece of dedicated land should go to the town or to the land trust. So the Conservation Commission makes that recommendation to the planning board. The planning board then makes their recommendation as to where that dedicated land should go. We see it as problematic to have people serving on a commission and a planning board making recommendations who are also serving on a board of directors that have an interest in acquiring that piece of land, even though it's all for the good of the town. For us, it clarifies the division of responsibility. If somebody wants to serve on the planning board during that tenure on the planning board, this policy would negate their serving as a board of director on the board of directors of the land trust, but certainly not to negate their giving input to the land trust or being a member of the land trust. And perceived conflict of interest is something that we run into all of the time. And it's a problem that we've had on our planning board with people being unable to vote on several different occasions because of conflicts. If we added this as another conflict of interest, I think we might have a difficult time getting a quorum on that board from time to time. So this is an issue that this policy is attempting to address. And it is not the intent of anybody on this council to say that members who have served in both capacities have not done a good job and are not serving to benefit the town. I think we all appreciate all the work that members of the land trust have done, particularly the board of directors. And it's an issue that we've talked about with Nat and other members of the board at least the last 4 or 5 years. Of course, another way of addressing the same problem is to eliminate from our ordinance that ability for that 10% of dedicated land to go to any organization outside the town. That would be another way of addressing it, which we have talked about before and decided not to do. I think this is a more reasonable approach.
Are there other comments to this particular item? Councillor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I hope you can all appreciate how seriously concerned we are about the appearance of a conflict in that it appears to perhaps undermine the planning board process. If you have a planning board member who is serving as an ex officio member of the directors of the land trust. An ex officio means that they're serving on a board because of their participation in another capacity. It does allow them to vote. This is something I had learned when I first looked at this 3 years ago. If, consider the situation where a planning board member votes as a director of the land trust regarding the disposition of a piece of open space and then comes back and sits as a planning board member. There have already been discussions with that member. It could be considered a type of ex parte communication almost. We don't want one planning board member to have had discussions or be involved in discussions that other planning board members are not involved in. That, for me, is the underlying issue. I'm focusing on planning board. I thank Peter for bringing up to us the point about the Conservation Commission, and yes, that does come under different state statutes than a planning board does. I'm aware of that, having seen how a Conservation Commission has been set up recently in a different municipality. I think Jane's point about us having a 5-member planning board, and if a planning board member had to excuse themselves from consideration of an entire subdivision review because of this kind of situation, they're not serving the town as well as they could. We're trying to minimize the number of times planning board members have to excuse themselves. That's paramount when you only have a 5-member board. And if you only have 4 members show up some night, yes, we have alternates, but it doesn't work well when people get themselves into this kind of situation. This is what it comes down to. The coordination I value very highly. I hope we can work together to find another way to coordinate the land trust and the planning board situation. Conservation Commission, I don't want to really deal with right now because I think we should look into that further before we get into a recommendation about including Conservation Commission in this. I do have one question for Dr. Rand. Is there currently, Dr. Rand, a member of the town planning board serving as a director of the land trust? And if so, who is it?
No, there is not. Nick Tinsman was. He is presiding from the planning board.
Okay.
I asked of Ms. Etzel to replace him as what started this nature.
Oh, okay.
So he's last, at least, position.
Okay, good enough. I hope you will understand it's not a matter of trust, it's a matter of appearances. I have had to stand down from decisions on the council where there was no financial remuneration for me because of the situation, but there was the appearance of a conflict. I refuse to get caught in those appearances, if I'm aware of them anyway, and I don't want that happening to our appointed officials. We're trying to keep this a win-win situation for everybody in the town. As I said, I hope we can work together, find another way for the coordination to continue, because it certainly serves all of us really well in the long-term picture, and that's what it's all about. We know the good work that's done, but we have to uphold the integrity of our planning board. Thank you.
I don't feel that I can add anything to what Councilor Amrow and Councilor McLaughlin has said, but I do hope that you feel that we are here as members of the council to try to stay away from what appears to be conflicts. And I would think the boards would serve better if they meet as a board on a project and not have one member of the board get firsthand information and carry it back to another board before the two boards have a chance to meet. And I think that was a reason that the Conservation Commission was separated out from the planning board originally way back to conserve, and that they should meet as boards and not as have individuals going back and forth before the board gets together.
Any other input from the council at this particular time? I do see a hand. Why don't I ask Mr. Boomer to come to the podium? And
thank you. I'm John Boomer, and I live at 9 Delano Park, and I'm a director of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust and its current treasurer. I've been serving on that board since its inception. There were two points that I'd like to offer as potential clarification. First, when it was brought up about the 10% land set aside, as I understand it, that's an either-or situation. The developer in question does not have to give 10% of land. He or she can give money instead. So this, the concept that they have to do it, they have to send something to the town in terms of land or the land trust, to me is very false. Second thing, it seems like there have been some developers that continue to remain nameless that are causing this turmoil. And the appearance of that doesn't feel very good from where I'm standing, and I'd like to know who those developers are.
I'm not sure it's our prerogative to answer, but I do think our town manager can at least make a comment to your question, Mr. Boomer.
I don't have a recollection which developer it was, but at one of the public meetings that I know some of the councilors either were at or saw on TV, a developer said that they were giving to the town when in fact they were giving to the land trust. And then they were corrected, and then the developer said, well, it's one and the same.
Okay.
And it comes out of that, and we probably have a videotape of it even. Okay. But to be honest with you, I don't remember which developer it was.
Okay, well, that sounds, to me, a basic lack of information. That developers need to understand that we're a separate organization. We've got bylaws. We'll happily hand them to anyone. We'll accept memberships. And for somebody who's dealing with the town of Cape Elizabeth seriously, they probably ought to get their facts straight, who's who. So that, again, from my side, does not seem to be anything more than a simple misunderstanding, and should not require these draconian measures to separate these things. Thank you.
Dr. Rand.
Just briefly, the developer who was confused received the letter well in advance that Nat sent it. The letter that Nat sent was to the developer, who subsequently said that he was confused as to who was the land trust and who was the Conservation Commission. It was quite evident in that letter how we stood and which was which. I would like to say I still don't see the conflict, ladies and gentlemen. I'm sorry, but I don't. I see lots of conflicts on the planning board, in the realtors and the developers who are on it, and the kind of conflicts you're talking about are minuscule, and in fact they are to the advantage of the town, not the type of conflicts you're talking about with the planning board. I would ask that rather than vote on this, I'm aware that the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission does not know about this issue. Their chairman is unaware of it. He is aware of the item that is in the agenda, but that doesn't explain to him what the issue was and the fact that it involves members of his board. I don't know about the planning board, but I would ask, does the planning board know about the discussion we are holding tonight and the impact on their members of what you are about to do?
I can answer that in terms of, I don't know the specifics of how much the planning board knows, but I do know that they received the letter asking for an appointment. The council indicated that it wanted to get an opinion from the town attorney. The letter from the town attorney, and they were told that the council is still looking at the issue. But beyond that, I don't know what they know.
In my view, in view of that lack of participation and in view of the potential legal problems that I discussed, it might be well to consider tabling this issue. Thank you.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, I would like for the members of the audience and the council to know that the chairman of the Conservation Commission of Cape Elizabeth did contact me this morning and showed me a letter he'd received from you, Dr. Rand, over the weekend when he was away, had opened it this morning and said, what agenda item are you, is this, what's going on, basically. Granted, he had only my input from the council. I tried to give as clear and succinct an overview of the situation as I could. He said he had other commitments this evening, did not think he would be here, but I did try to fill him in as best I could about the proceedings I expected this evening. Thank you.
Is there any other comments from the citizens on this particular item tonight? Are there any other comments from the members of the council on this particular item? It appears that there has been a lot of information conveyed this evening. There are some unclear issues in my mind with respect to the position of the Conservation Commission in the context of this particular item. I'm clearer about our town's attorney's position on the planning board. I'm not as clear, and I am loath to assume his position with respect to ex officio membership of a member of the Conservation Commission on the governing board of the Land Trust. So I think we're in a position of either someone making a motion on the particular item or making a motion to table this particular item until our next council meeting.
I'd like to make a motion that we table it, Mr. Chairman, until the Planning Board and the Conservation Commission and again the Land Trust can all meet with the council, and let's hear from the other two units as well as the Land Trust. That would be my thought.
Do I hear a second? I will second the motion. Any discussion?
Can't discuss it, if you don't discuss it.
Excuse me, you're right. We should vote on the motion. All those in favor? All those opposed? The motion fails 5-2.
4-3.
I'm sorry, 4-3. Excuse me. 4-3. The motion fails. What is the will of the council?
Mr. Chairman, I'll try another motion. I would like to move that we amend the statement of policy appointments to standing boards and commissions by adding number 8 to read, members of the planning board may not concurrently serve as members of the governing board of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust.
I'll second the motion.
Mr. Chairman, I purposely omitted the Conservation Commission. I think if we do want to consider that situation, we should have more input, legal input especially regarding the state statutes under which the a conservation commission, and presumably ours in this town, is established.
I heard a motion, and I heard a second. Is there further discussion? May I have a roll call vote, please?
Chairman Creelman?
Yes.
Councilor Cogswell?
Yes.
Councilor Amaral?
Yes.
Councilor Chappell?
No.
Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor McLaughlin?
Yes.
And Councilor Pearson?
No.
Motion carries 5-2.
The motion carries 5-2. Item 37, to consider two proposed amendments to the traffic regulations and take any necessary action. I will defer to our town manager, Mr. McGovern.
Yes, in the approval process for the commute for the for 1226 Shore Road, I almost misnamed it. The zoning board had a couple of suggestions regarding parking and traffic flow in and around the property. Specifically, right now, there's no parking allowed for 350 feet on the paved way of Shore Road northerly from Route 77. They are very concerned that people might start parking on Shore Road in front of the community, in front of 1226 Shore Road. And they're suggesting that they're suggesting that there be no parking in front of the 1226 Shore Road. So it's suggested to follow through on that requirement of the zoning board in their conditional approval that section 13-2-2Q, no parking at any time of the traffic regulations, that a new section, that section 4 be changed to read no parking at any time on either side of Shore Road northerly from Route 77 to the northerly property line of 1226 Shore Road. Second, they were very concerned that as people were dropping people off at the side door of 1226 Shore Road, the traffic might be backed up onto Shore Road, thereby causing traffic congestion on Shore Road. And they asked that the road be posted, or the driveway be posted, excuse me, at 1226 Shore Road to read no parking or no stopping any time. So this would be a new section that would read section 13-2-2Q, section 13, no parking at any time and no stopping at any time on the driveway connecting the town hall lot with Shore Road. And any amendments to the traffic schedule are subject to public hearing, and I would recommend that these proposed amendments be set for public hearing at your August, I believe, 12th meeting.
Thank you very much. Any discussion on this particular item? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I had a bit of confusion in my mind about the Section 13 language. I did talk today with the Code Enforcement Officer, Ernie McVane, with Dr. Bruce Sarbeck, who was acting chairman of the Zoning Board the evening the 1226 Shore Road project was before them, and did also speak with Mr. McGovern. I appreciate the concern of the zoning board regarding the backup of traffic onto Shore Road. If you're going in from Shore Road in the driveway and headed towards the back of, yeah, towards the back of Town Hall that way, that if people are stopping to discharge passengers and there can be a backup of cars onto Shore Road, that's something that none of us want to see happen. And Dr. Sarbeck also mentioned the concern they had if you're stopping there, somebody gets out on the front of the passenger side, they have to cross in front or in back of your car, maybe crossing in front of a car coming towards them, coming towards Shore Road from the back of the town hall parking lot. That was another concern they had. And I ran by the gentleman today, the scenario of dropping off my 80-odd-year-old mother. I said, yeah, come on, this doesn't make any sense to have absolutely no stopping along that driveway. it seems to me that we don't want stopping if somebody is headed in from Shore Road. I don't see the problem if you're headed from the back of the town hall lot to Shore Road, and they're on the passenger side. They can get out that door and easily get into the building. As I said, I ran that scenario by both the code enforcement officer and Dr. Sarbeck, and they both felt that it was in keeping with the concerns of the zoning board, that that would not conflict with the conditions that the zoning board had discussed at its meeting last month, I guess. So I would hope that we would amend the revision to say in number 13, no stopping at any time on the southwest side of the driveway, which is the side closest to 77 in Town Hall.
The southwesterly side?
You may add the LY if you're so disposed.
It's just in form with the rest of the ordinance. It doesn't necessarily make it right or wrong, it's just in form.
Thank you, Counselor. Other input on this particular item? Counselor Jordan.
Yes, I had a problem with that also, on the no stopping. And it goes back to one of my thoughts way back, that that should be one way from the town hall out towards Shore Road so you don't run into this. And I would like to know, and I'm kind of in agreement with Councilor McLaughlin has come up with, that who's going to police it, whether I drive Grammy in from Shore Road and start and let her out, who's going to be there to give me a ticket and what have you, or what you're going to do about it. I'm just going to start and let her out and run across to get into the building, and I think it's ridiculous. You either ought to have it one way, so they all have to come out that way, and that wouldn't happen, then try to put some language in here to help prevent it, which I don't think you will. They're going to do it.
To answer your question about enforcement, it would be very difficult to arrest someone for dropping off their 80-year-old grandmother. And the problem with municipal projects is that everyone has an opinion on them, and I'm not directing this at you, Councilor Jordan. But we essentially go through triple jeopardy on at least triple jeopardy on every project. We need to get the planning board, the council, and the zoning board all agreeing exactly together on every aspect of the project, and that's extremely difficult. Councilor McLaughlin's amendment is approved, notwithstanding the comment that Dr. Sarbeck made over the telephone, nonetheless, it's not a part of the record, and I would still go back to the zoning board for an amendment to the approval to ensure that the town was in keeping with the conditional use approval. But hopefully the town center committee will look at the entire way that, particularly in the VA zone, that every use, not only municipal, but others need to be approved by both the planning and zoning board. And it gets to be extremely difficult when the boards sometimes contradict each other.
Just to add something to that, I mean, you're going to have a real traffic pattern there, and I'll bet you the best steak dinner in the city of Portland, somebody's going to drive down Shore Road in front of that building and let somebody off. Just stop long enough to let somebody off. So I don't think you're going to correct this no stopping deal. No stopping and no parking is two different things.
We don't have a motion on the table yet. Councilor McLaughlin, you have discussed a particular amendment to Section 13. I'm taking it that that's acceptable to the council, the southwesterly side of the driveway. Is that a general accepted amendment to the particular stated sentence at this point?
I'm for one. I don't agree with it. I'll vote against it.
I for two don't agree.
Okay. I'm hearing that you don't agree on Section 13. Is that correct, or not the actual amendment, though, of the statement? What I'm beginning to think is that we may have to take two votes on this particular issue, first Section 4 and then Section 13. Is that a possibility at this point?
Excuse me, the way I understand this, that you can't drive in that driveway either way and let somebody else. You've got to get into the parking lot and then get back out of the parking lot in order to let somebody out. Is that correct?
That was by the original proposal, but by Councilor McLaughlin's amendment, you could still drive heading out and drop someone off on the
right.
on the, that side of the building.
I understand that. But who's going to police if I go the other way? That's my problem.
I'll be out there every day.
Okay, thank you. We'll leave it up to LP.
That's why I was going to volunteer.
Councilor Amaral.
I'm trying to remember the plan for 1226 Shore Road. Is there no drop-off place at all?
The discussion at the zoning board meeting was that the handicapped spots at the front of the building could be used for drop-off purposes. The other point is that we do have the 20 parking spots that are not really that far away from the building. They're just beyond that fence. Even though it's not far, people sense the distance. It's no further than walking to this podium to the handicapped spot in this parking lot, but people perceive it as a greater distance.
Well, if it's going to be used by senior citizens regularly, there ought to be a place to drop people off.
Is there enough
of a door?
Yeah.
If it's the council's desire, I'll go back to the zoning board and express the council's view and as the applicant and try to get an amendment. But, the zoning board is an independent body. They can do whatever they want.
Yes, Councilor Coxall.
So are you saying, Mr. McGovern, that in the zoning board's discussion that they felt that the handicapped parking areas would be adequate stopping space to let people off?
They felt there would be an opportunity for drop-off there. They didn't get into a discussion of adequacy.
But they didn't say
what if
cars could be coming both ways. Yeah, what if it's full?
I can't speak for the zoning board.
I can understand and appreciate their concern for personal safety as far as running across the road and dropping someone off, but you still could have a problem with cars coming in from two different ways, trying to pull in and then back out and go in the opposite direction, dropping someone off.
Yeah, they seem to have a very strong feeling that everyone would be arriving at the exact same moment. And, even though the capacity for the building is only 50, because of load limits and everything else. But they thought that everyone would arrive at the exact same time, and this is not verbatim, but the traffic would be backed all the way up to Route 77. That's an exaggeration on my part, but they were afraid traffic would be stacked up out on out on Shore Road.
Councilor Jordan.
If I may, once more. My concern, and as I vision this building is going to be used primarily or a good part for elderly people, and I should think the plan that comes forward should be laid out best served for elderly people. If we have to take part of the front lawn or we have to make other areas so they can get in and get dropped off easily without creating a traffic hazard on Shore Road, which I agree that shouldn't create it, but seems so there's land enough back there. Maybe they don't want to take a tree down, or maybe they don't want to do something, but they should go in there and have a turnaround or something so they can come back and let people out where it's easy if it's going to be used with Grammy and myself and what have you.
Mr. Manager.
Yeah, Councilor Jordan, that's exactly the reason why it was made to be two-way and not one-way, was in order to facilitate dropping off at the door. It was kind of a surprise when the zoning board raised this issue, but it is one that, conceivably, it is possible that there'd be a backup, and it's weighing the inconvenience of, maybe it might back up sometime versus having the elderly dropped off further down the road. The other point that was discussed quite a bit at length was to have a point that there'd be no stopping so far in the driveway, and then beyond the point, you know, X number of car lengths in, stopping would be allowed. But again, you know, it'd be difficult to enforce.
Councilor Coghill?
Is it possible to use one of those handicapped parking spaces in front and have it designated for drop-off only?
No.
No.
And I think it actually, you know, I think that causes more problems, because the more the handicap spots are going to back up into the driveway. And if you're looking at, you know, elderly people dropping off elderly people, which is what usually happens, they don't really like to drop to back up if they can help it.
I qualify for that.
Again, it appears that we're in a situation of either needing a motion to table this item for the town manager to return to the zoning board, or moving the item 37 in its totality with Councillor McLaughlin's amendment. Councillor McLaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question of the manager. How many handicap spaces are currently being proposed at the front of the property? Are those the only two being proposed?
In
that
the whole site plan is more than that, but specifically that, you know, would conceivably be used for this property, this too.
Because there are no handicap spaces proposed for the 20-odd spaces towards the rear of that property.
No.
Okay. My recollection of the site plan drawings is that there's still going to be pavement going up to the existing garage door.
What's happening, instead of the driveway going straight out onto Shore Road, it is going to come off of the new driveway. So the cars aren't backing out directly onto Shore Road. So instead of coming in directly toward the garage at a 180-degree angle, it will instead come in at a 90-degree angle.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I would like to put forth a motion that we set to public hearing. That we have to do with this?
Yes.
I'm sorry, I'm lost. Set to public hearing on August 7:30, 10, Council Chambers, two amendments to Section 13-2-2Q, no parking at any time, of the traffic regulations. Section 4, to be amended to read, no parking on either side of Shore Road, northerly from Route 77 to the northerly property line of 1226 Shore Road. And Section 13, a new section, and no stopping at any time on the southwesterly side of the driveway connecting the town hall lot with Shore Road.
I have a second.
Mr. Chairman.
I was asking for a second.
Yes, I know. I'm not seconding. I was just going to propose another amendment. Another motion.
Well, without a second, that motion fails.
Mr. Chairman, I withdraw my motion.
Thank you. Councilor Coghill.
I would amend Councilor McLaughlin's motion to just delete southwesterly side.
Do I hear a second? Hearing none, the motion fails.
Do we want to set this?
We have just discussion on the table at this time. Councilor Coghill, you had a question.
I wanted to know if we just want to set for public hearing these changes as they now are and get public input on the item and then make our decision. Or do you, because that stands in another month.
Mr. Manager?
Based on the discussion, I would hope that someone might allow this process to go forward and have Section 13 read no parking at any time on the drive, just the new section be on the driveway connecting the town hall out with Shore Road. Do away with the stopping provision and instruct me to go back to the zoning board to have further discussions with them on the stopping bit.
Do I hear a motion including that amendment? That would be Section 4 as it's currently printed. And Mr. McGovern, would you go over again your suggested Section 13 as to its reading?
Section 13 would read, no parking anytime on the driveway connecting the town hall lot with Shore Road.
I could buy that.
Can you buy it with a motion, Councilor Jordan?
Yes, sir.
Second.
It is moved and seconded. Further discussion on this item? All those in favor? I'm sorry, there is further discussion. Councilor McLaughlin.
Go to somebody else. I've lost it.
Councilor Coxall.
I just wanted to ask the manager, isn't there already a prohibition for parking on that driveway anyway?
This driveway hasn't been constructed yet. It's the new one.
Right.
Yeah.
But with the site plan review and the approval of the zoning board and everything else, did they allow parking on this driveway?
The zoning board did not allow parking or stopping.
Okay, but this just says stopping.
Yeah, the planning board is holding a public hearing a week from tomorrow night on this proposal, on the entire site plan for 1226 Shore Road in the town hall lot.
So this proposal you're bringing to us tonight is not the complete one that was given by the zoning board, since they said no stopping or parking?
This is exactly what the zoning board required for conditional.
So it just says
conditions.
Councilor McLaughlin.
The memory's starting to kick in again. I want to make sure I understand the process that we may be facing with this kind of amendment. The zoning board set forth as a condition of approval that there be no stopping on that driveway.
That's correct.
Correct. Does the planning board require the applicant to adhere to the zoning board conditions before they will give final approval?
I can't speak for the planning board. The planning board is an independent body that can make its own judgments.
Okay. My experience is that some planning boards would only accept the concurrence with conditions of approval from another entity. I'm wondering how this may affect the project's outcome at next week's public hearing when the applicant was hoping for final approval. When would the applicant next be able to go forth before the zoning board to request a revision of the conditions?
I think we have not. I don't know if the zoning board's having a meeting this month. I believe they are because they had a kettle cove.
Mm-hmm.
Not kettle cove. The two lights issue was tabled to the July meeting. So, yeah, it'd be the fourth Tuesday of July, whatever date that is.
And
I was hoping to get final planning board approval on the third Tuesday in July.
I don't know what the requirements are for requesting to go on a zoning board agenda. I don't know if we would make their deadline for July or not, even.
Yeah, it's a simple issue. I would be asking for an amendment to the conditional use that they remove that condition, and that doesn't take much time to prepare that and that explanation of the council discussion.
Right. I don't know what their deadlines are. So those are just things that, you know, we need to know what the procedures are, what hoops that we as the applicant are going to be going through. I just wanted to have that discussion. I thank you.
Councilor Coxall.
Mr. McGovern, if we just table this until our next meeting, we'll give you time to complete, hopefully, the planning board and possibly an amendment with the zoning board. And then we can hold our public hearing, and we'll be holding a public hearing on what really has been approved. Does that make more sense? I'm trying to go ahead now and set a public hearing for August when we really don't have the exact wording yet.
We have the exact wording of what the zoning board approved.
Right.
And that has been communicated to the town planner to communicate to the planning board. The planning board is having a site walk tomorrow night at 6:30. We'll see what they say.
But the motion we have before us now does not reflect the zoning board's decision.
No, it does not.
We have changed it. That's what I'm saying.
But an attempt to have the zoning board conditional use clause go forward failed for lack of a second. Councilor Jordan.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, to clear the cobwebs out of my head, is that we should, as I gather between the conversation here, put to a public hearing or table what is proposed here in this section as recommended by the zoning board. And then maybe we could make that change at the public hearing or not.
Yeah, the more I think about this, that's exactly what I think you ought to do, even though it failed for lack of a second, I'll still push for it, is to set this for public hearing, and if meanwhile I'll go to the zoning board and try to get the no stopping taken out, and that'll be before the public hearing, and if that doesn't wash, or if the planning board doesn't put it in the meantime, or does put it in, I'll report back to the council at the public hearing, and you can make a judgment at that time of whether or not to enact this as a council, or to substitute it in conformance with another board decision, or third, delay the project and ask for an amendment to both again, but you know, it might be November before we finish the process. And the building remains empty.
Well, in listening to Council McLaughlin, I take it that we shouldn't make changes on their recommendations before it is backed, and let them try to persuade them to make the change. Is that pretty much what you were thinking?
Yes.
The applicant should try to persuade them to make the change.
Right, rather than us doing it.
I withdraw my motion if the second will agree. Just to move it forward, then I might make one at the table.
Was the second withdrawn?
Yes.
Yes, okay. There's no motion on the floor. What is the will of the council at this particular time with regard to this item? Councilor Jordan, were you going to be making a motion?
Yes, I'm going to make a motion that we table item 37 until our next council meeting.
Do I hear a second? Hearing none, the motion fails. Councilor McLaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we set to public hearing on August 12th, thank you, at 7:30 p.m., Town Council Chambers, two amendments to Ordinance Section 13-2-2Q, no parking at any time, of the traffic regulations. Section 4 to be revised to read no parking on either side of Shore Road, northerly from Route 77 to the northerly property line of 1226 Shore Road. And Section 13, new section, and it would be no parking and no stopping at any time.
Wait a minute.
Zoning board was no parking and no stopping.
Just no stopping.
No stopping.
And no parking?
It's already under the
no parking
section.
Oh, okay. That's the intro to all of the subclauses.
So that people understand it's no parking and no stopping at any time on the driveway connecting the town hall lot with Shore Road, these being the two conditions put forth by the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Board for this project.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Thank you. Is there any further discussion on this item?
Read that section 13 again, will you, please?
The town clerk possibly read section 13 for us again, exactly as it will be.
Section 13 is a new section. It would be no parking and no stopping at any time on the driveway connecting the town hall lot with Shore Road.
Discussion?
Please.
We've had too much, I think, already. I'd like to see it called a public hearing, but I can't go along with no stopping when it comes to a vote. I can go along with no parking, but no stopping means to me just what it says, and if somebody stops in front of me, I can't stop. I got to go right through. And it does, it's not good wording in my estimation.
Councilor Amaro?
I don't think anybody likes Section 13 the way it is, but I thought what we're doing is setting this to public hearing with the understanding that we ask the manager to go back to the zoning board and ask that that item be amended to take out the stopping. But at least we'll have this language before us for the next meeting, hopefully with the zoning board after they hear this, the discussion tonight, being willing to reconsider their action on that item.
That is the understanding.
Yes, the motion is to set it to public hearing.
Correct.
Yep. Before, prior to which or at which we may change the language.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to vote. May we have a vote? All those in favor of setting this to public hearing, raise your right hand. All those not in favor? 6-1, the motion carries. Item number 38, to consider scheduling a public hearing on the condition of the former Scout House at 1231 Shore Road and take any necessary action. I will again defer to the town manager on this particular item.
I think you're all aware of the condition of the Scout House over right around the corner here on Shore Road. It's been unoccupied for about 15 years. The code enforcement officer has been working quite aggressively over the last few months and years, in fact, in trying to get the current owner, Stephen P. Virgilio, to make repairs to the building. Specifically, letters were sent on May 16, 1989, March 30, 1990, April 1, 1991, May 1, 1991, and May 31, 1991. As indicated in the Cape Courier, I was quoted as saying, I still hope this can be resolved without tearing the building down. You know, I think whenever the council does a possible judgment of a nuisance, that is an objective. But at the same time, I do feel strongly that the building is a nuisance, that it's dangerous, that it's dilapidated, and that it does meet the conditions of the state statute by which you can condemn a building. But I would hope that by setting a public hearing and by accepting comment on this, that perhaps the owner of the building would realize that the town is sincere in wanting to have the building cleaned up, and that there is no question that unless positive action is taken, that perhaps would be the judgment of the council after a public hearing. So I would recommend that you find the building a hazard to health and safety because of inadequate maintenance, dilapidation, and because it constitutes a potential fire hazard, and that you schedule a public hearing for Monday, August 12, 1991, after which you would judge the building to be or not be a nuisance and dangerous, and to consider making and recording an order on what disposal should be made of the structure.
That's very clear. Is there someone in the audience that would like to respond to this issue?
I'm Stephen Vigilio's wife. The house has been, we would like to fix it up. We did have plans. I think it was about 3 years ago we came to the planning board with plans to uprise it. It was turned down. At the present time, everybody knows there's a recession going on. We don't have money. The building, he's willing to throw a paint job on it, redo the landscape, get it updated, but we need help with the police department on keeping the kids out of there. The teenagers of this good old town of Cape Elizabeth have broken out the windows in the building. Why should we replace them when we can't get help in keeping it updated? It is an old building. He does have plans that he'd like to do. It's a matter of money to fix it up at the time. But, I mean, we've done what we can do. The boards are on the building because stuff we've set against the doors does not keep the kids out. I've gone to Chief Pickering asking him to post the building with the police notice that the police are taking notice of the building and the kids going in there vandalizing it. He won't do it for us. There is the back of the building is structurally safe in regards to what Mr. McBain said. It's not, it is safe. There is a hole in the front of the building which is under repair at this time, and you're willing to go up and in the building and look at it. As far as being a hazard inside, no one belongs in there but us. But we are fixing the hole in the floor.
Thank you, Mrs. Virgilio.
Counselor Cogsell.
Yes. Did Mrs. Virgilio receive a copy of the fire chief's report, inspection report, as of June 28th?
I'm not sure that that one was sent, but as you will note that the pile here of other letters that were sent to Mr.
Right.
Virgilio. To my knowledge, no notices have been sent to Mrs. Virgilio. The property, I think, is just under the name of Dr. Virgilio.
Okay.
But I don't believe that they did directly receive the letter from the fire chief. The intent would be that if a public hearing is set, we do have to give due legal notice, and they would receive all of this documentation, as well as anyone else who has any interest in the property, and we would have the town attorney do a title search to ensure that everyone was notified of the hearing.
Councilor Jordan.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, if I may, I would like to ask Mrs. Virgilio, what are your plans if you do fix it up? What do you have in the back of your minds of going with the building?
Well, what do you intend to do when the money comes?
Would you come up to the mic?
His intentions, the last we talked about, is he'd like to put offices in there, possibly a daycare. But it's a matter of everybody needs money to rebuild something. If you can get the Historical Society together to help fix the windows, that will be great. Everybody likes the building. It's an old building. Then maybe they can come up with some funding to help with it, because we just can't do it.
No, I was just wondering what you had in mind as far as a building.
Offices.
Just office spaces.
Office type thing.
Something
maybe
to
possibly
that effect.
Daycare type thing.
Or what it could be used for and what would be allowed. That'd be allowed then, wouldn't it?
Yeah. Dr. Virgilio also owns the lot next to it, and
yeah.
The lot by itself, you can't do much with it because there's not any parking, but, you know, the code enforcement officers had similar discussions for 2 or 3 years with the property owner, and nothing's been done. That is the record of what's occurred.
No, I understand that, and my point was, if they did have the time, what did they have in the back of their minds they were going to do with it? That's what I was trying to get cleared up, because I think I know as much history of that building as most anybody here on the council, because I remember when it was a garage, and it was a garage for a good number of years before the front was put onto it.
Any other discussion on the council with respect to the issue of setting this to public hearing? May I have a motion?